Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Zakim's Kitchen Home Edition. I'm Stephanie Meyers, the Nutrition Coordinator at the Zakim Center for Integrative Therapies and Healthy Living, and thank you for joining us today to talk about sweet potatoes. I was thinking about this the other day that we're now 9 months into our remote programming and how the seasons have changed as we've sort of tried to stay in season with what is fresh in the New England area, and the fact that we're at nearly Thanksgiving is sort of shocking. But along with us today is Megan Acosta, our program coordinator, and she will be moderating our session. So if you have a question or a comment, anything you'd like to add to the discussion, please don't hesitate to type it in the chat. And Megan will get those questions forward on your behalf. And I also want to let you know she'll be sending you the slides and the links to the recipes from today's discussion. So we'll get started in talking about sweet potatoes. I have been thinking a lot about how we're only a couple weeks out from Thanksgiving and how sweet potatoes at our Thanksgiving at least have center stage. And so we're going to talk about sort of the basics as usual, the nutritional benefits of these sweet potatoes, and also sort of how to store them and some tips for preparing them. And then we'll make one recipe together today. But I do want to put a little teaser in that if you're available around 2 weeks from today when we do our Thanksgiving episode of Zakim's Kitchen, we're going to have some more things that have sweet potatoes in them. So, but for today, the basics are here. So we've got fiber, vitamin C, potassium, and a whole host of what's called the carotenoids, which are the pigments, the phytonutrients that give vegetables their deep orange color. So this pigment is also found in butternut squash and in carrots, anything else with that orange color. And it is a very potent antioxidant. So that orange color is definitely something we're wanting to have regularly in our diets. When you buy sweet potatoes, you want to keep them stored in a cool and dry place away from heat. So if you think about what cabinet you typically put your sweet potatoes in, it's best if they're not like right next to the stove or right above the stove. And it's also best if they're not next to any other produce. When I say any other produce, I mean especially onions. We've talked in previous episodes of Zakim's Kitchen how when you have onions in the same cabinet as potatoes and sweet potatoes, the onions, as they ripen, the onions giving off the gas in the cabinet with the sweet potatoes cause the sweet potatoes and potatoes to sprout. So their eyes start sprouting and your sweet potatoes will deteriorate faster if they're in a cabinet, sort of like in a bin even with other things like especially onions. Sweet potatoes fall into the category, as most fresh produce does, of something you don't want to wash until you're ready to use it. And also when you're washing it, especially if you're getting it at a farmer's market, there might be quite a bit of dirt still left on it. Wash it well under running water. And if you have a little veggie scrub brush, you want to take that to the skin of the sweet potato as well, especially if you plan to eat the sweet potato skin, which I would advise if you can tolerate that little bit of extra fiber. There are quite a few nutrients in the peel itself as just beneath the peel. So anytime you're able to keep the skin on and eat the skin, it's advantageous. And then lastly, you don't want to refrigerate a raw sweet potato because it causes it to break down and spoil much faster. Obviously, if you've baked or roasted the sweet potato and you're storing your leftovers, they belong in the fridge. But when you get sweet potatoes home, you don't want to keep them in the fridge. Really, the only time I would keep a sweet potato in the fridge when it's raw is if I were just using like half of a sweet potato and saving the other half for like a recipe later. But best not to keep raw sweet potatoes in the fridge. In a cool, dark place is best. All right, let's talk a little bit about some of the ways you can prepare sweet potatoes. I want us to think differently than sort of the typical traditional like Thanksgiving dishes where we're sort of adding extra sugar. I mean, some of those casseroles with the brown sugar or the marshmallows on top, we're hoping, for some they taste delicious. The notion of what we want here is to have a sweet potato dish that lets the sweet potato shine through on its own without any need to add extra sugar. So you can bake them, you can roast them, you can steam them, you can saute them. We'll talk a little bit about that today. You can grill them and you can mash them and you can also eat them raw. That was a surprise to me, actually. I just learned that a few years ago, that sweet potatoes are actually something you can eat raw if you like the crunch. Just be careful because it really is only sweet potatoes, not all varieties of different yams. You really can't eat all different types of yams raw, but sweet potatoes you can. Not that you need to. Certainly fine if you prefer to have them baked, roasted, sauteed, steamed, or grilled. So let's talk recipes and ideas you can start. It's never too soon, in my opinion, to start searching for your Thanksgiving recipes. And here's a great first stop. This is from Bon Appetit, and it's their 31 healthy-ish sweet potato recipes that they couldn't stop making. Now, there's quite a few on this list that I make regularly, and I just want to name a few of them because, again, the notion here is to try to think outside the box of what you usually do with a sweet potato. So a few of the recipes I really love that you'll find on this Bon Appetit are the dinner salad. It's a radicchio salad that has roasted sweet potato. And it just, the playoff of the radicchio flavor and crunch against the roasted sweet potato is just phenomenal. There's also a very basic recipe I love in here, which is called meal prep roasted veg. So it's basically for those of you who might, like, on a Saturday or Sunday, roast a big cookie sheet full of vegetables for the week. They have a great basic recipe here that has cauliflower and sweet potatoes. Really, you can mix and match, but it gets you sort of, if you've never gotten into the groove of that meal prep veggie tray, it's a great place to start. There's a black lentil roasted vegetable bowl that's got some harissa on top. There's a wonderful sandwich that's a spiced sweet potato sandwich. And there's also a miso soup that's got sweet potato and turmeric. So again, this is one link to go look. Just the pictures themselves are beautiful. And the recipes are very, there's a wide variety of options here for things to do with sweet potatoes. Here's a couple of my other all-time favorites. These were close contenders for things I wanted to make with you today. But of course, with a limited amount of time, we had to go with something that's pretty straightforward. So this is from the Minimalist Baker, and it's her sheet pan meal. And we've talked a lot in Zakim's Kitchen lately about trying to get dinner to happen, like really happen in 30 minutes or less, get it made in that amount of time. And here's what I love about this recipe is it's literally one sheet pan. You cook the whole thing on the same sheet pan, so fewer dishes and less cleanup. And it's got sweet potatoes, of course, but also purple cabbage, which is in season right now in Massachusetts, and also chickpeas. So it's a vegetarian protein. Obviously, you see how she plates it here. It's just beautiful. And the other thing I love about this is that it's got a great array of spices. So there's fresh ginger and garlic and onion, but there's also curry powder and garam masala. So this has a lovely depth of flavor, and she tops it off with lemon juice and tahini. And she serves it with steamed kale. So again, if you're looking for something that's totally different, perhaps a meatless meal, you can make an entree that, like I said, is going to go on a sheet pan in your oven and get all done at once. This is a great recipe to put a bookmark on. I made this one a couple of nights ago and it was a real hit. It was the first time I had made it. This is from The First Mess and it's a stew, a coconut, lentil, kale, sweet potato stew. And it was delicious. It was that really cold night that we had just maybe Monday night, I think, when it had been kind of strangely snowing in the morning and really frigid. And I made this particular stew that night and it was really delicious. It's excellent as leftovers. We even ate it over whole wheat couscous the next day for lunch. So this is a great, easy work from home dinner that can be used as leftovers for lunch. And then I of course want to give a nod to Love and Lemons because she does some different and interesting things with sweet potato recipes on her website. Now for this recipe, she technically uses a stand mixer that has a veggie sheet cutter attachment, which I don't have. But you see here how she's made essentially lasagna noodles out of sweet potato that she's used that attachment. Anybody who has that veggie attachment, it's a, you know, like a, for like a KitchenAid stand mixer where you have different attachments you can put on, like a pasta attachment. There's an attachment that's called vegetable sheet cutter, and it cuts vegetables into these thin sheets. But I've made this before just using a mandolin, and it doesn't have to be these long, beautiful sheets. Like if you just take a sweet potato, peel it, leave it whole and slice it on your mandolin, then you can just lay the thin slices in the pan and spread the layers. And one other thing I've done often with this is use both whole wheat lasagna noodles and a sweet potato cut into these thin planks and then alternated layers just to get some more vegetable, or, you know, technically sweet potato is a starch, but to get more of that beta carotene, more fiber, and to just, it's really beautiful when you slice it to have those alternating layers of whole wheat lasagna and the thinly sliced sweet potato. You technically could also just slice your sweet potato with a really sharp knife as thinly as you possibly can. Although I will say the mandolin, getting it thin, really thin, helps it to get fully cooked. So that's just one piece you might want to take into consideration and what tools you have in your kitchen for making this recipe. Okay. And then we're almost to the one we're going to make today. There's so many good sweet potato recipes and more to come in our Thanksgiving episode in 2 weeks. This one is amazing. The minimalist baker has taken a noodle dish, and there's no noodles in this dish. It's sweet potatoes. Another kitchen gadget here is a spiralizer, which we've talked about on the show before. But if you're looking to spoil yourself this holiday season, or even just to give yourself a $15 new kitchen gadget that can tuck away easily, a spiralizer might be worth the investment. You take a sweet potato, you put it through the spiralizer, and it turns into these noodles. This recipe is super easy. It's 8 simple ingredients, garlic, nutritional yeast, any type of milk or milk alternative. So you can use almond milk with cashews and sea salt, red pepper flakes and kale, and that's it. And it turns into this really scrumptious dish that's garlicky, and it's phenomenal. And again, the noodles are made from sweet potato. So different spin on sweet potato. That brings us to what we're going to make together today. I would say this is one of my family's all-time favorites. Both kids shrieked with delight when they saw what I was setting up on the counter for today's live stream, which is the twice-baked sweet potato from Love and Lemons. And I'll just tell you as we get ready to make this, the things I love about it. I roasted the sweet potatoes this morning, so I was thinking ahead for tonight's dinner. I set the oven to 400, I tossed the sweet potatoes in whole, and I roasted them for an hour. So we're gonna pick up from that point. But what I like about this is it's a pretty easy dinner to throw together. It includes some steamed broccoli and this cashew cream sauce we're gonna make in a minute, which is absolutely delectable. And you put those things together and you stick these potatoes like back in the oven for 10 minutes later tonight. And they're really a delicious meal unto themselves. So this is what we're gonna make today is the Love and Lemons twice baked sweet potatoes. And before we do that, I'm just gonna pause to see if there are any questions so far.
No questions at this point in time, but feel free to send any questions, thoughts, comments you have in the chat, even if it's not related to sweet potatoes. Yes. We can talk about it, but yeah, send those questions on through.
Thank you. And thanks, Megan, for reminding me. Sometimes I get so focused and spend all week getting ready for talking about sweet potatoes. And then I forget, like, yes, if you have another question, please don't hesitate to ask. So here I have this tray of sweet potatoes that I prepped this morning. Like I said, I turned the oven to 400, baked 4 sweet potatoes whole for about an hour. And then once they cooled, I cut them in half. And you can see I've already gotten to work here because the first step of this recipe is taking out a little bit of the sweet potato. You need to make the cashew cream, we need about a half a cup of the sweet potato that's already been cooked. So I'll just show you how I do that. With the sweet potatoes in the tray, I take a grapefruit spoon and I just make a little circle on the sweet potato. These are already baked, so they're nice and soft. And I'm just taking out like a small, these are so tender, a small amount, like making a little hole in there. That's where we're gonna put this delicious cashew cream in a little bit. So once I've given each sweet, taken a little bit out of it off the top of each sweet potato here, made a little bit of a boat. You don't want to hollow it out too much, but you want about a half a cup. I've got a pretty generous half a cup here of the sweet potato mash. And we're going to first make the cashew cream for these sweet potatoes. It works best if you have a high-speed blender or a food processor for this. And we're going to do, there's 6 ingredients that go into the blender for this recipe. The first is going to be a half a cup of water. I've made this in the past with veggie broth too, especially the homemade veggie broth. I just happened to use that up last night on my curry lentil stew. So water, half a cup, that mashed sweet potato, which is half a cup. And then the star of this recipe is raw cashews that you soak in water for at least 4 hours. So this morning when I put the sweet potatoes into the oven, I put a half a cup of raw cashews in this bowl and I just filled the bowl up with water and I let them soak. That's gonna soften them up enough and give them a really creamy consistency once we get them in the blender with the sweet potatoes in the water. I drained them. So I soaked them for 4 hours and then I drained the water and I rinsed them. So this is just raw cashews that have already been soaked, and that's going to go in as well. Then we want 1.5 tablespoons of lemon juice and a clove of garlic. You don't have to bother too much with chopping these things up because the blender is going to take care of that for us. This recipe, I had forgotten, it calls for rosemary, which I'm out of rosemary, and my herbs have now, my fresh herbs in pots on my patio are now gone for the winter. So we're going to have to put in, we're going to have to pinch hit. That's it. Yeah. And I have fresh thyme that's dry, not fresh, thyme that's dried. So I'm just going to sprinkle a little thyme in, figuring that that flavor will work nicely with what else we've got going on here. And then a little bit of salt. You can measure if you want. She calls for 1/2 teaspoon. I usually just shake a little in, and a little bit of black pepper. And now we're going to blend this up, realizing that sometimes you have to add a little more water. So we'll see how this goes. Yeah, it gets thick pretty fast. And we want to let those air bubbles out. So I'm just using, I've shown you this before, this long stem spatula. Just going to give this a little bit of a stir and see if I can get, what we're going for here is a really smooth puree. We don't want any chunks of cashews. We want this to be a nice creamy, like you would see like a butternut soup, squash soup kind of consistency. Gonna need a little more water. It's really good. I think it's because I put a little extra of the sweet potato in. This particular sauce is a big hit in our house. So a little extra we enjoy. I'm gonna put a little more water, just a splash. You can also use a little more lemon juice here. And then we'll see, this should now turn into a nice smooth puree. So one more round on the blender. Or more. Really thick today. All right, it's the texture is right. It's just a little bit too chunky with the cashews for me, for my taste. So I'm gonna try. All right, we're gonna call that good. And I'll pour a little bit out here so you can see the texture. So it's thick, almost like a pudding kind of consistency. And that's what we're going to fill in the sweet potato with. So I'm not going to bother taking all of that out, but you get the idea. This is the cashew cream. We're going to use that in a moment to start filling the sweet potatoes. And then the other piece of this recipe is the broccoli. And this is a really straightforward recipe as well. I've already steamed the broccoli. So what you'll do with this broccoli, you clean it and cut it into florets. And then I put it in a steamer basket and put the water beneath. And then I steamed it for only 5 minutes. You wanna keep it nice and bright, that green color, not overcook it, because this is gonna go back in the oven for 10 minutes again. So 5 minutes steamed, like I said, on the stovetop steamer basket above the about 1/2 inch of water. And to that, we're gonna add a clove of garlic. This is a nice, if for those of you who like garlic, this recipe is full of garlicky flavor. For those of you who don't, you can leave it out. So we've got a clove of garlic. We're going to put a little more lemon juice in here. This time, just 1 tablespoon of lemon juice. So garlic, lemon, 1/2 teaspoon of Dijon mustard. And I'm, you know, you can mix this up in a bowl separate if you want, but I just tend to plop it in. Trying to keep dishes down is one of my main agenda items during the pandemic. I get to the point where I'm loving making a huge mess in my kitchen and spending most of the evening cleaning it up. All right, so we've got garlic, lemon juice, Dijon mustard, and if you are open to it, 1/3 cup of shallots. So we're going to sprinkle green onions, scallions, not shallots. All right, so that's what we have for this. We're going to toss this around. This is now sort of turning into like a, it's just a little bit more exciting than steamed broccoli on its own. I mean, you get these flavors all together, the cashew cream with this garlicky mustard, broccoli, it's really nice flavor. All right, so we're ready to assemble. We have our cashew cream, sweet potato cashew cream, and our steamed broccoli that has a little bit more of a flavor enhancement going on. And I'll show you how you assemble this. It's pretty straightforward. You take that tray of sweet potatoes that you had already made the little divots in, and you start with the cashew cream first. So I take a scoop of this cashew cream and I put it right into this hole that we had made for the, when we scooped out that. I like to be generous with this because once you get these out of the oven, especially if you're planning to eat the skin, that cashew cream, and you cut this, it's just phenomenal. So you get the cashew cream and you pile it on top and it fills in that nice little hole. And then using clean hands or your spoon, you're gonna take some of that broccoli that has the Dijon mustard and garlic, and you're gonna put that on top. So I'm piling up the broccoli on top of the cashew cream like this. And the recipe calls for just a little shredded cheese on top, as well as hemp hearts. And I did take out hemp hearts to show you. Hemp hearts are these little seeds. What I like about them, well, first of all, there's 3 grams of protein in a tablespoon. So just this little extra dusting of protein and a little bit of an extra bit of texture on these. You can certainly leave these off. If I don't have hemp hearts, I'll sometimes do slivered almonds or a little sprinkle of sunflower seeds. When they show this plated, they also put microgreens on top. So for any of you who aren't familiar, they're sort of like broccoli sprouts or the equivalent of like an alfalfa sprout, but different types of sprouts. That is shown on top as well as sort of like a little garnish. I've also just put a sprinkle of fresh parsley. There's really any which direction, a number of different directions you can take these stuffed sweet potatoes in. And then once you have the tray all assembled, you're gonna put it back in the oven for about 10 minutes. And that's just to warm everything through. Everything's already cooked and ready to go. Questions at all? Or ideas or thoughts about making this stuffed sweet potato?
Thanks, Stephanie. If you don't want to eat them all in one day, should you keep the sauce and broccoli separate so you can eat it for a few days?
This is such a great idea. So this is such a great question. I've done it both ways, where I've filled them all, made them all, and then put them in little containers for lunches for the week, so it's like literally all ready to go. I happen to think this tastes really good cold, like personally. So if you can do it either way, and it doesn't deteriorate. The cashew cream, what happens when you put it in the fridge is it kind of solidifies a little bit. So once you bake it in the shell, as it is here, it will stay together. So it's okay to make all of the sweet potatoes and then plan to eat them within 3 days. It doesn't freeze very well. So that's just one thing to take into consideration. But you easily could just keep, well, also, let me just say, this cashew cream is delicious on other things. So I eat this on whole wheat pasta. I'll eat this on a spread of toast with some roasted vegetables on top. I've even been known to throw it on top of a salad, just like a little scoop, like you might like a scoop of hummus. So one of the reasons to perhaps keep the cashew cream separate is you might find yourself using it to top other things just because the flavor is really nice. So this recipe, I find the cashew cream makes more than you need for the 8 potato halves. So you'll probably have a little bit extra of the cashew cream anyway. So I guess it really comes down to how quickly you plan to eat the sweet potatoes. And if you're going to eat them within 3 days, you can easily make them all and keep them in the fridge. If you're going to go longer than that, because the cashew cream is going to last in your fridge for about a week. So if you plan to use the cashew cream for other things, then you might keep your sweet potatoes unadulterated and just fix them up as you're ready to eat them.
Thanks, Stephanie. Next question came in about how do you tell the difference between sweet potatoes and yams? They are not always separated properly in the store.
Yes. If they're not separated properly in the store, it's a guessing game. I found myself recently looking at the PLU sticker to see if I could figure it out that way. Like there was a sign that said like yams, but then there was this whole mountain of, you know, sweet potatoes and yams that seem to have intermingled. I wish I had a great tip for you on that, apart from sort of asking someone in the produce section who might know. But yeah, I think that unless they're well labeled and you can, or you're really familiar with sweet potatoes and distinct varieties of sweet potatoes and yams, it may be difficult to tell.
Thank you. Do you eat the sweet potato skin?
Yes, if possible. I would encourage you to eat it, but you need to clean it thoroughly. So that's why I was saying perhaps investing in a small veggie scrubber brush that you can use to clean outside of the skin. But you can keep the skin on when you're making sweet potato wedges, sweet potato fries. And also for this recipe, it's really delicious. Certainly you can just eat the sweet potato, scoop it out of the shell and leave the empty shell, sort of like a boat. But you also can eat the shell with this and eat the skin with it rather. And it's pretty delicious if you can handle that, a little bit of extra fiber.
Thank you. There are no other questions at the moment. We have just a few more minutes. So if you do have other questions, please send those in. And then Stephanie, do you want to talk about what's coming up?
I do. So next week, we will not be live on Zakim's Kitchen Home Edition. So nothing next Wednesday, but we hope you'll join us next Thursday for the last of our two installments of Zakim's Ask the Nutritionist. Next Thursday at 12:45, we'll be talking about easy work from home lunch ideas. And then the second Thursday in December, we'll be talking about easy work from home dinner ideas. So please come back next Thursday, 12:45 for that. And then I'm really excited to tell you that Meg and I have been working on planning a Zakim's Kitchen special edition for November the 18th, which is a week before Thanksgiving. The theme obviously will be Thanksgiving. And we'd like to invite you who are interested to cook with us from home. So if you know you'll be along with us for Zakim's Kitchen on November the 18th, same time, 1:15, and you want to have the recipe in advance, so you can either purchase or order your groceries and have them ready to go, we will cook a dish together on the Zakim's Kitchen Home Edition that day. And again, the theme is Thanksgiving. I can promise you we're going to have a kale, butternut, cranberry panzanella, which is a favorite of ours at Thanksgiving. And I have a couple of other, I'm going to share lots of recipes that day. We're definitely going to make one. And we'll have, like I said, a list of ingredients for anybody who wants to shop ahead or include those ingredients in their grocery list so that you can actually cook along that day.
Thanks, Stephanie. I'm very excited about this. This is something new that we're trying. So again, if you're interested at all in that, you can email me and I will add you to our list and send out the list, the recipe and list of ingredients in advance. You could cook along side Stephanie.
Go ahead.
No, go ahead, finish.
No, I was just going to say that we've really been hoping to help people find the ideas and recipes we are talking about in this to feel actionable. So if that feels like something you'd like to try is taking that next step and do a practice run before your Thanksgiving week, then we'd love to have you do that. So
another question came in is why should you not eat yams raw?
They're not all of the phytonutrients in yams are digestible, so they can make you ill. So you want to make sure you're cooking your yams thoroughly. Sweet potatoes have a slightly different profile nutritionally than yams do. So just that differentiation, it just has to do with the fact that if you ate too much of them, you could actually make yourself ill gastrointestinally. Something you don't want, right? Steer clear of that.
Thank you.
Yeah.
That's it that we have. There's one other question that I'm going to respond to offline. But other than that, again, if you have any other thoughts, questions, comments, please send them over. I will be sending out today's recipe and Stephanie's presentation this afternoon. So you'll have that. And then feel free to give us any feedback that you have from there. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Have a good day. Stay safe, everyone. See you next week.